Well, you know, everybody always tells you not to pick your specialty before you go to medical school and to try a little bit of everything. I knew probably that I wanted to do something related to the mind slash brain. And I did never make a big differentiation between the different kinds of brain things, you know, ranging from neurosurgery to neurology to psychiatry to neurophysiology. The next summer, I took an elective that involved a psychiatric rotation. That same sophomore year in medical school that I was giving birth to Robin and taking the boards in the fall, I spent hours and hours and hours collecting articles on the effects of lithium on sodium, potassium transport, and on the adrenocortical system. And I found a psychiatrist, his name was Russ Noyes, who had an IND to use lithium. And this was before lithium was FDA approved. But I heard about Russ and went to him and said I was interested in doing a research project. He nicely welcomed me. I first went to a renal physiologist in the Department of Internal Medicine, whose name was Walter Kirkendall. And he was one of the most admired medical school faculty. And here I am, I'm still this little girl, probably 28 years old. But, you know, I'm 4'11 and I weighed 100 pounds and I have always looked far younger than I really am. So, you know, from his point of view, here I am this little girl coming into his office with this, you know, this is pre-computer era, with this stack of 3x5 cards on which I had laboriously made all these notes and put together all these ideas about how lithium might affect both somatic physiology and brain physiology. And I showed all of this to him and he said, "I'm so proud of you." And this was probably the first nice thing anybody had said to me in medical school. Mm. He said, I'm so impressed that one of our students would have done something like this. You know, so much original work, so much thought put into a problem like this. He said, I can't help you because I'm a renal physiologist. You know, and you have to find somebody who knows about the brain because that's where this is all going to really matter. Mm-hmm. And that was my first project in psychiatry, which became my first paper in psychiatry. I was a really good medical school. It's the only medical school in Iowa, and it serves the entire state. We, in our training, saw hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of patients. And because it's Midwestern, it's, you know, very practical. The psychiatry department exposed you a little bit to psychodynamic thinking, but we were really mostly in the medical model. Mm-hmm. Nothing strange about thinking about bipolar illness as a brain disease. The faculty in Iowa thought that mania was illness that could be treated psychodynamically. Mm-hmm. And nobody thought schizophrenia was an illness that could be treated psychodynamically. So anyway, I did that work on lithium, and in the process also met my first person with schizophrenia. I met psychiatric patients for the first time, and that really hooked me on doing psychiatry. We were talked about a serotonin hypothesis of psychosis before Herb Meltzer had ever talked about it, a serotonin hypothesis of psychosis. We had an active chemistry lab attached to our hospital, so it was just a splendid environment for a young, curious psychiatrist to be working in, because we were trained in other things like psychometrics. We had a strong psychology division, and they wanted us to know all about how cognitive tests worked, and so, you know, I was trained to administer OASIS, and we had a strong electrophysiology lab, and I spent 6 months doing an EEG rotation. So I got a really good general psychiatric education, and eventually emphasized the use of experimental cognitive tests to assay the brain, and spent a good chunk of my time also kind of purifying the descriptive psychopathology of mental illnesses. At the same time, was working on the inpatient wards. The wards were a little bit specialized in terms of the kinds of patients, and I chose to work on the ward that had the more severe psychotic patients. As I began to focus more and more on schizophrenia, I became deeply interested in the language abnormalities that you have in that illness, or the thought abnormalities, however you want to express it. That was a natural for me because, you know, I come from this background in language and literature. I kept asking, how can we accurately measure the disturbances in language and thought? I did a lot of work in descriptive psychopathology that I think is pretty classic, thought-language communication disorder scales.